Good afternoon, all participants. I welcome you all to the last day of this one-week faculty development program on outcome-based education and the NBA accreditation process. Our expert for this session, Professor Sanjeev Sofath, is already there. Professor Sanjeev Sofath is presently working as professor and head, Computer Science and Engineering Department, Punjab Engineering College, Chandigarh. With an illustrious experience of over 3 decades in teaching, research and consultation, sir has also held various positions like Dean Student Affairs, Dean Academic Affairs and Deputy Director at Punjab Engineering College. He has also been consulted widely and invited for talks, seminars in India and abroad, including UK, Malaysia, Singapore and China. With over 100 papers to his credit, sir has also been actively involved with the national NBA in various capacities. So, sir may be enlightening us on attainment of CO, PO and continuous quality improvement. I thank you, sir, for agreeing to conduct this session and I request you to now commence with the session.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Ritika. And thanks, Dr. Huda, also for inviting me for this particular session here. I hope my screen is visible.
Sir, your voice is breaking a bit. I suggest you may switch off your video if...
Okay. Okay, my first thing, is my screen visible? Because only then I can start.
Sir, your slides are visible. Yes, sir.
Okay. That's good. So, good afternoon, everyone. Maybe we have got a session with you, maybe for next one and a half hour. We'll be talking about attainment of a CO, POs and continuous improvement, quality improvement. Because you might have seen what exactly NBA looks for. One is, in general, what are the characteristics there? What are the information you have got about your faculty and other things there, which somebody might have talked to you. But major aspect of any NBA accreditation is outcome-based education. So, as we say, outcome-based education is, in case somebody asks you, why should I go through this course? Why should I do MBA? If somebody says, let's say there are 100 odd institutes in India who are offering MBA programs, why should I do MBA from your institute only? What will I get in case I do MBA from your place? That is a usual question which you might be answering once the students are asking you. Maybe some of you can tell me, because maybe what I'm trying to do is, of course, I got my engineering background. I'll try to focus more towards MBA there, because I got the feedback there are quite a good number of people who are with the MBA background. Now, let's say there is a very casual question I'm asking you in case somebody asks you, because that's how we take it the outcome. In case somebody comes to you, why should I do my MBA from your place? Maybe can I take one or two answers from you only? What is your take on this? Before we start with, yes. Yes, some of you participants.
I would differentiate myself with others.
Yeah.
Just miss other universities or colleges under consideration.
Okay. Anyone else? Maybe MBA people, usually they go for a case studies and other things. There is a lot of discussion which goes on there. I also like to have some sort of a discussion with you for my topic, right? Somebody says, okay. So basically vis-a-vis other institutes, I'll compare and tell him. But what is the gain he got out of it? Let's say there are five institutes who are equally bad. Then why should he do it?
Sir, it's a reflection on my work. On it is, it always gives me, keeping the accreditation aside, I would know how I am performing. So it is a scope of improvement. Like I can do my SWOT analysis for me.
Yes.
And if I go on improve, So if I go on improving, and if I can benefit from two ways. One thing is that if it's a private organization or any even a government organization, the name would automatically come. Then the admissions would be more. Then the university would be prospering. This is what I can see.
Right. Two questions. Some it's good. Okay. Basically, what you're trying to do is, okay, you're trying to reflect upon. This is the outcome which will be there in case you do MBA from my place. Your outcome can be, okay, let's say you, this student will get a job. So this is the outcome which will be there. Because let's say I go through a process, and what is the final outcome? Is it up to my expectation which is there? If it's so, I like to have it. If it doesn't up to my expectation, then why should I do it? So this is what we say, outcome-based education also. Okay. In case I go through a process and at the end of the day, my student expectations are something, that is my outcome. Whether I'm able to achieve my outcome or not, this is what I had to think about. Now, your course objective, program objectives, program educational objectives, they are all linked to that only. Okay, let's say, how will I say okay, you will be able to attain your outcome? In case they are in line to my program objective, there are certain courses there which are in line to that. And if there is one course which is going through, and there are some objectives and outcome which are defined for that particular course. Now, if I'm able to attain it, that will further lead to my PO's attainment also. So basically, it's a chain. And ultimately, what is my mission? What is my goal, which is there for the program? My goal is, let's say, I would like to produce such a good MBA people who are accepted by the industry without any hesitation. Let's say I do define this sort of goal there. Now, once I have to achieve this goal, I have to think about how can I achieve it. There is some process there. Maybe they have to go through some process. Processes, my some courses they have to go through, some sessions, some case studies they have to go through, some other things they have to go through. And based on that, I'll be able to attain it.
Sir, may I please interrupt?
Sure. Deepya.
A request is, my name is Dr. Deepa Dixit, that the slide that you're showing us, if it can be in a slideshow format, or if side windows, it will be better visible for us.
Is it fine now?
Yes, sir, absolutely. Thank you so
much. Okay. Hey, because I was just talking to you, that's why maybe I didn't.
Okay. Thank you.
All right. Okay, so basically what we want to do is, in case it's an outcome-based education, then what we have to do is, OBE is involved in your curriculum, assessment, reporting practices in education reflect the achievement of some order of learning. So what we say is, it's not an accumulation of course credits. Because obviously, in case there are 10 institutes, from every institute student are accumulating the course credits, then how you are different from the others? Maybe your curriculum may be different, your assessment techniques may be different. Maybe as in MBA, we say the more number of case studies you do, the more curriculum implementation, good implementation is there, or more assignment you give. So this is what we say. Okay, then your outcome was a process that involved your restructuring curriculum, assessment mechanism, reporting practices. These are some of the things which are there. And what we want to do is achievement of high order learning. Because obviously everyone is achieving, but I had to think about how can it be better than the others. This is what we say is the outcome-based education. How do we do it? Major component is your curricula. The moment I design a curricula, then based on that, I had to think of how will I implement that curriculum. Maybe in that process, what we have got is your assessment techniques which are there. Because how will I define whether, let's say there are two teachers there, both are teaching. There are some students, he says he's a wonderful teacher, they say he's a very average teacher there. That is based on your delivery system which you have got. And then your assessment. That this assessment, is it justifiable? That's really, so these are all the things are there which we say is the outcome-based education there, and curriculum plays a major role in that. So we have got certain critical terms. We have got a COs, we have got a TPOs. Now, what we say is the program outcome is what sort of a knowledge, what sort of a skills, what sort of attitude you're going to have. Once I go for a formal course, it's true for engineering, it's true for management also. And your profile of the graduate reach through the POs, that's what we have targeted there. And the one thing you should be very clear, maybe some other teachers might have told you, POs are defined by the accreditation agency there, maybe NBA in case of that. And that's why we say is the starting point. In case I'm doing MBA, these are the attributes should be there for it. Maybe I'll show you SAR, where they have mentioned some of the POs there. Okay, these are the POs which has to be there as far as your MBA program is concerned. And then we have got a course outcomes. One is a program outcome. Okay, once somebody goes through a program, what he will achieve out of it. And then next we have got is course outcome there. Okay, what we have got is statements of observable student section. Okay, they have attained knowledge, they have attained skill, and they have got attitude there. Maybe some of them are measurable. Maybe I can measure what sort of knowledge he has acquired there, what sort of skills he has acquired there. Can I measure the attitude? Because MBA people can answer this better. Can I measure whether something as an attitude, there is some changes into that. Maybe what we say is it's an indirect way of observing. Because knowledge I can measure, skill I can measure, knowledge, okay. In case I would like to see whether he has understood this thing or not. Let's say there is some course outcome which I expect. There was a certain objective which I kept for the course. There is a certain outcome for this particular course. Now I have to see whether he's acquired it or not. Now, in the layman's language, if I would like to find out whether your students have understood the course or not, that's what we say, knowledge and skill they could acquire. How do you measure this? Maybe some of you. How do you measure whether your student has acquired the knowledge, skills, which you have given to them? Yes, some of you.
So one way could be the evaluation, the exams that we conduct. Another is the continuous evaluation. Whether it is presentations or projects that we give them, then the final exams. These and how they perform vis-a-vis the course object outcomes that we have defined.
Yes, you're very right in saying, in case I would like to see whether they have acquired the knowledge, whether they require the skill, I'll see it's a continuous evaluation which I'm going through. Then each of the continuous evaluation I evaluate, and each of this particular exam which has been delivered to them, I evaluate, and then I say, okay, now let's say you assume all the students in your class has got 90% marks. Yes, somebody says, he said, these are some of the different tools which are there, some messages. Yes, good, you send me, keep on sending me messages. Because these are some of the tools through which we see. These are measurable tools which we say. Now, once I got these tools, I can find out whether he got the knowledge or skill. Let's say if I like to see attainment. Now, if I would like to find out what is your attainment out of a course, let's say I go for a direct measures, your continuous evaluation and your final evaluation. Let's say most of the students have got 60% marks in your class. So what will you call it? Then what is your achievement in this case? Yes, maybe I will keep on answering.
So maybe if it is 60% and you have defined it at a particular level, it depends on what level you have defined, isn't it?
Right.
So if it is at a level of, say, 1, 2, or 3, then probably it is at level 1 and you have not attained. But if you want, so at least 75% of the students who have got that, then have attained.
Yes, you're very right in saying, hey, let's say in case on the average, my class average is 60%. On the average 60% marks are there. I can say my attainment is 60% only. Or in case there are out of 60 students, there are 10 students who flunked, who failed in a particular course, because obviously these sort of things do happen, then that can also be one measure of your attainment. This is what we say, this is my attainment which is there. In case I got a 60% of the score, 70% of the, maybe let's say I taught this course first time, my class average was 60%. Next time I taught this course, I got 70%. Next time I taught, it came at 80%. What will you say? So this is what we say is the continuous improvement. Okay, let's say I'm taking up this course. Then based on the feedback only, based on whatever measurable things I have got, based where I could see the knowledge and the skills, now I could find out, yes, 60% of the in first year 60% attainment was there, next year 70% attainment was there, next year 80% attainment is there. Then I try to give some, as somebody says, give 1, 2, 3. Let's say you can say, if 60% results are there, I say good achievement. If 70% results are there, very good achievement. If I say 80%, I say excellent. 90%, I say exceptional. So that means I can just classify my achievements, attainment, based on that only. So whatever course outcomes you have kept, because how will I, let's say I kept 4 outcomes. Now which outcome I have achieved? Maybe that will depend upon your question paper. We will talk about that also. But at this stage, you can see achievement or attainment is whatever you attained after doing this. Now, then another thing, while you start teaching a course, you might keep a level of attainment. This is my target value. What is the target value? Initially, let's say you start with a course. You go to the first class, you see wonderful students. What do you say? Arre yaar, ye sare pass ho jayenge. Or they will perform very well in my course. Maybe within 1 or 2 sessions I can find out. So this is what I just keep. This is what my I imagine this will be my target. Because MBA people, they keep on doing targets and the achievable there. It's similar to that only. So what we say is, and then last is the attitude. That is the indirect measures. Because I can't measure his attitude. There is some attitude changes which has happened in him. There's other indirect measures which are there. And direct measures, indirect measures combined together gives me the attainment level. Maybe I'll show you some of this people, how people are doing it. So each course is designed to meet the course outcome. So what we expect is every course we are teaching, every course we are doing, have to meet some of the course outcome there. And course outcomes are statement in such a way that there can be actually measured. Each of the statement can be measured over there in case we wanted to go for the details. And POs are attained through the program specific courses. Let's say you have got 5 POs which are there. Maybe Professor Grover might have talked to you about the POs. Let's say there are 5 POs which you have kept. Now each of the course will not take care of all the 5 POs. I can say that one PO is attained by one course. Maybe there is another course which is there for attaining the second PO. We have to strengthen this. So what we do is we try to build up a system where the most of all the POs are attained by some courses. That is what we say, attainment. In case I have taken 10 courses, then these 10 courses may should lead to some of the POs there. One course may lead me to attain one PO, other course may help me in attaining the other PO. Now, my next question, can one course attain all the POs? Let's say I got 5 program objectives which are there, outcomes which we thought of, and is it one course can take care of all the POs? Yes.
No, sir.
No, yeah, you're very right in saying, because in that case, what will happen? In that case, for attainment of the POs, if I take, well, there is one course which can help me attaining all the POs, maybe I'll conduct 2 courses of that type. That's not possible. So this is what we say, okay, there may be some courses through which my attainment level of a PO is very high. For the other course, for the same course, for the second PO, it's a very mild, I would say. It's a high, low, or. So this is what we say, okay, we have to see how much program attainments are there from a specific course. And how do we define this COs, POs? Program outcomes, another definition, the knowledge and skill set that the graduate have at the time of the graduation. Once they do their MBA, this is the knowledge, this is a skill set they are acquired. With what conviction I can say that will depend upon my outcome. And course outcome is knowledge and skill that attained by graduate in a particular course. I think there is a lot of a difference between program outcomes and the course outcome. Course outcome is specific to only one course, whereas program outcome is based on the whole program. Let's say my program is MBA. Okay, given this particular MBA, these are the knowledge and skill set which at the time of graduation this fellow should have. And course outcome is based on only one course, what is the knowledge, what is the skill he attained in the course. And what we have to do is we have to map this COs with the POs there. That's what, as an MBA document, we have to do this mapping. As I told you, on the x-axis, you can keep all your POs. Let's say there are 5 POs there. And on the vertical, you can keep all your COs. Then you try to match each of these course outcomes with the program outcomes there. And this mapping we call as a COPO matrix there. And how we do it? That is through your curriculum. Curriculum, assessment, and evaluation, the major tool which program outcomes are attained. So what we say is, how do we have a program outcome? In case we have got a very good curricula, we have got a very open, transparent assessment tools, and they're sufficient in nature. I can be very transparent in case I conduct only one final exam. I show all the answer sheets, everything I do. But is it completeness? So what we look for in an MBA accreditation is your curriculum there, where you have gone for the COPO mapping, and is there some assessment tools through which you're measuring it? And evaluation are the major, that's what we say, they're the major tools which program outcomes are attained. And this is what we are to design over there. Now, once I'm having the curriculum, your self-assessment report which you send there, they look for these answers. Okay, process for development of the curriculum exists and has been followed. Maybe some of you might be a standalone MBA institutes who are making their own curricula, and there may be some others who are affiliated there. So maybe can you, some of you, share the process for development of curricula exists and has been followed in your institutes? Is this statement correct? Yes, some of you. What's the process for development of a curricula, if I ask you? Somebody says leaving mobile, joining through laptop. Okay, that's fine.
Sir, basically, benchmark POs would be there, and on the basis of those POs, we are going to develop our curricula. Right. And in curricula, we are going to take care of all course outcome as well as objectives.
Yes.
Objectives which we are expected to cover through that particular course, and course outcome, which is the expectation at the end of it, students are what students are going to get that.
So, yeah, that's it.
And apart from it, these COs are going to be mapped ultimately to POs. So ultimate goal would be to achieve that POs through different courses. So benchmark would be POs.
No, our first statement which we say is let's say curricula is there. Now,
yes.
If we were to see what is the process for development of the curriculum, maybe some of you might be involved on curriculum design. How many of you were involved in designing of any curriculum?
So basically, problem is I'm from Tier 2 institution, so we don't have control over those curricula. But I think faculty who are from Tier 1 institute may give this idea.
Yeah. Anyone who is from Tier 1 institute?
Sir, can I answer?
Yeah, yeah. You're most welcome.
So, what I would look out is that if we are looking for the development of the curriculum, I would start from the examinations. Assume that I have ran a course in this semester and have completed my examinations. Now, I would be, or the individual teacher would be looking up at how the students have performed in each and every of the course, and then his observations or her observations would be put forward to the department. The department would then discuss, saying that these were the drawbacks that we had, and these might be the solutions. So we will incorporate the solutions and maybe change the curriculum or add something, delete something, and then have a discussion, put it to Board of Studies. And the Board of Studies would discuss, then they may accept some changes. While going before Board of Studies, some inputs would be obtained from students and also inputs from the prospective employers and other stakeholders involved in. Once that was put
yes.
to BY and then discuss about, and there can be some additions, deletions. The final would be then put to the Academic Council. Then the Academic Council approves it. Then we will be rolling it into the coming semester, whenever it may be.
Okay, that's wonderful. You've given your curriculum design development process in a nutshell, in a very crisp way. Your process is, okay, first of all, let's say we identify the stakeholders. Who are the ones from whom we are making this curricula? That's one thing. Then who are the other stakeholders there? Let's say your industry is one of the stakeholders. Your students are one of the stakeholders. Faculty is another stakeholder. And these are, and maybe alumni is another stakeholder there. That means what we have to do is, while we frame curricula, we have to involve all these people there. Now, once I had defined ki these are the stakeholders there, then I had to think about at what level they are to be involved. As you said, as for your faculty is concerned, faculty will be involved. Okay, let's say the faculty who is teaching the courses this time, there will be some feedback which will be coming from the faculty. Okay, this is the feedback which is there as far as the curricula is concerned. And based on this particular feedback, I will be, as you said, you will be redefining the curricula, where whatever, if it is the existing curricula, what are the changes required in that? Maybe there will be some new courses which are to be introduced. There are some courses which are to be deleted, and there are some contents to be changed over there. So this is what is done at the level of the design of the curricula there. Now, once we have designed this curricula, then there will be a small committee who is doing it. Then I had to take it to the broader people. Can I keep it open for the faculty, alumni, and other stakeholders or industry to comment upon your curricula? And once you get all the comments, then you try to incorporate these comments. Then you go to your board of studies, faculties for the approval of the curricula there. Now, what NBA looks for is, because what I was telling you is, NC seeks answer for some of them. Okay, what NBA is looking for is, okay, they would like to find out whether this process has been followed or not. If it is a tier one institute, responsibility is higher there, because in that case, they have to define this, they have to have this as a documented process for development of the curricula. That's one thing which is there. Then have we followed this particular process or not? So whatever are the proofs which are there, let's say you conducted one meeting, then you send this to 100 alumni, then you send it to 100 students, then you send it to all your faculty there. So all this needs to be documented, minuted, and this is what SAR looks for. Because usually we say, as an expert, once we go to some institute, at the end of the day, they say, no, we had designed all the curriculum, but what we're looking for, is it documented well? So this is what we say, process for development of the curricula exists, has been followed or not. Then another is, curriculum is well balanced. How do we check whether the curriculum is well balanced? Maybe our first yardstick is, whether whatever POs we have defined, is it all the course, with the help of all the courses, I'm able to attain all the POs or not? That's where my metrics becomes very important there. So this is what we say, the curriculum is well balanced. And level of syllabus, is there the level or not? I may be meeting all the POs, but my level of syllabus is very low. So this is another thing. Then another is, does it allow the NBA program outcome to be attained? Because NBA has defined some of the POs as far as any program is concerned, whether they are able to attain it or not, is what our answer is. So this is what we say, the team, this is a process and the results. We keep on having the process, question, and the results there. Now, this is what we have to answer. Will be able to attain POs under the curricula? Because what we say is, my curricula is the most important component as far as system is concerned. Whether with this particular curricula, I'll be able to attain POs or not. This is most important component which is there. Now, maybe then important is your core content delivery. How exactly these contents are being delivered? Maybe usually we say class notes of students, course file, textbook use, demo during the lecture, attending lecture, your attendance. So all these are nothing but the delivery part. Once NBA teams comes over there, they look for this information. A most important component is the course files here. The course file, all this information has to be there. Your course outward sort of course objectives are there, what is the outcome which is there, and how much is the attainment level which you have for this particular course there. So this course file acts as a evidence for the direct evaluation of the course file from the course files. Okay, from the course file, this gives me evidence whether your attainment is there or not. Let's say you got this particular, how do we take care of this course file? Let's say, because usually we say we have to look for the 3 years data. As any NBA accreditation is concerned, be it MBA, be it engineering, be it pharmacy, everything. It's a 3 year data. Now what we are trying to look for is, okay, the moment, let's say there is a course file there. Course file has got all this, your scheme of the things, the way you taught this particular course, your evaluation scheme is there, and we evaluated, maybe you have 50% for internal assessment, 50% for external, and what are the components for the internal assessment? Maybe you got a quiz, maybe you got a case study, maybe you got so many other things which were there. So that is the evidence for the evaluation at the NBA level only. And then we come up with the metrics. Okay, one student have got this many marks in first assignment, this much in the second assignment, this is in sessional, this is in the case study, this is all the marks are there. Then his final marks. And based on that, we try to see how much marks he's got in the whole of the semester there. So this is what we say is the course file content which has to be there. Use it, and that I tell you, this is the link which is between faculty and NBA team, because there may be team who is looking at the NBA there, but since this is a 360 degree evaluation, so what we do is every faculty member has to come out with his file, course file, and that acts as evidence for his direct evaluation there. And from there, we can find out whether all the evaluation has been done and what sort of attainment is there in, for this particular course, and what is the target value he's kept. Target versus his actual attainment are the measures over there. And we say this is progressive files. What do you mean by progressive course file is, okay, let's say, I taught this particular course this semester. Then once this course next year again comes, the file is passed to the next instructor and he builds his file upon that only. So that at the end of the day, I've got data for all the 3 years. And from there, I can find out whether there is any improvement, which is continuous improvement, which is happening there or not. That's what we say, overall importance of detailed and well-maintained course file cannot be overstated also. And it's the prime responsibility of the faculty. So all the faculty who is teaching that particular course is duty bound to come to NBA team and explain there how exactly he has done this particular course. So these are the measures where we say we go for the attainment levels. And all your attainment levels are there in your course files on. So this is the process which we have got. Your curriculum teaching learning, course outcomes, program outcomes, and the PEOs which we attain out of. This is what we say is the framework there. Maybe somebody has already talked about a curriculum design flow, defined POs and other things there. We are not going to detail of this. And that's what NBA team look for. Okay, it's a good practice to embed your course outcomes in the syllabi only. Because usually they see your syllabus. What they expect is your syllabus should be a part of your course file. That is the file, the course which you taught should have this course syllabi there also. Now, what we say is, whatever outcome you're expecting of this for this particular course, this should be part of a syllabi only. Maybe most of the universities these days, while they design their courses, curriculum, they come out with this, what is the program objectives, and then they boil down to course objectives, and then there's a mapping, the COPO mapping also, and then corresponding to in the each of the course syllabi, there is a initial term as course, what sort of objective I have kept, and what is the outcome from this particular course there. So that's what we see. NBSA is what sort of good practices are there. This is one of the good practice. You embed your course outcome in the syllabi only. Usually this answer, this program for development of curriculum, this has been followed EBCRT, yes or no. Maybe your dean and evaluator all the time, they will say it's an excellent curricula. But what NBA is looking for, maybe this is a cartoon, small cartoon which is there. Your NBA evaluator, he tries to find out, yeah, it's a very good curriculum which is there. But how did it come into being? Your dean will keep, HOD or dean will keep on saying. So this is what we say, the process is most important. What is the process which you have done to make this particular evaluation there? Now, curriculum well-balanced is, this is a slide which is there. What does it mean is, whether whatever is the expectation from the curriculum has been of the all the stakeholders have been met or not. So this is what we see, the balancing act. The pyramid is there and you try to balance it out. Otherwise, you will fall in the ocean. That's what it reflects upon. Okay, if in case your curriculum is not balanced, obviously you will ocean is all the other institute who are following this sort of practices there. So that's what we say. Any curriculum is a well balanced, fairly balanced, or could have been better balanced. That's what the review committee tries to find out. So what we have got is, we have got a curriculum, we have got a teaching, learning, assessment, evaluation processes, and we have got a course outcome, we have got a program outcome. If it is existing there, then is the whole of your work is done.
So I have a question, may I?
Okay, you should.
Right. So when you are saying a well balanced curriculum,
yes,
what are the elements that you are looking at with respect to balance?
Basically, once we say whether the curriculum is balanced or not, what we are trying to look for is, whatever other POs which were there, they have been met by all the courses which we have thought of. And is it state of the art courses which are there? Maybe because what this NBA team, they keeps on changing their with the periodics, really, they keep on changing their POs also. So is it, I'm meeting all the POs or not, is one of the yardstick through which we've tried to find out whether curriculum is balanced or not. Then another is whether it is meeting the expectations of all the stakeholders or not. In case it is meeting the stakeholder expectation and it is meeting all the POs there, then usually we say it's a well-balanced curriculum.
Okay, thank you, sir. So the POs which are mentioned for MBA programs, and we did not really see anything separately mentioned, but the POs which are there, I mean, we also have our own program outcomes defined. So as long as in spirit it is meeting the ones mentioned by NBA, I suppose that is fine. It doesn't have to be verbatim the same, right?
What you have to do is, those four or five POs you have to meet. But in case there are some other POs which you would like to have, this is a PSOs.
Okay.
In case I can, let's say you thought of that there is another one or two more POs you would like to have, you can have them as a PSOs there. That is program specific outcomes. Okay, let's say I belong to a place where there is a lot of industrial setups there. My MBA people who to go, they have to go in this specific industry where I need this sort of a knowledge, this sort of a outcome which they are really looking for. I put up there, then I try to match it with one of the issues there.
My question is that, you know, I think the new POs have been defined recently.
Maybe whatever has been defined.
Yeah. So by NBA, whereas, yeah, you know, we have defined this almost about 3 years back. And like you mentioned that the NBA looks at 3-year data. Now, I can't go in retrospect and change my POs because I've designed my curricula on that. But it is in synchronization with what the new words are. So, presenting a table of what NBA is saying and what we are doing and how there is a synchronization. Is that a good enough way of presenting when the team comes? Is my question.
Yeah, yeah. That's a good enough to present this way also.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Maybe then we look for the assessment tools which are there. Okay, let's say there are 12 POs there. Now, what are my direct tools? What are my indirect tools which are there? Maybe all these things you are doing, you are going for a test, you are going for assignments, you are going for the lab, seminar, industrial training, project. All these are your direct measurements which are there as far as any course is concerned. And then we got an indirect measurement. One is course and survey. Another is the exit survey, faculty survey, alumni survey, program statistics, some statistics there. So these are some of the things. I'm not saying everything you should have. Maybe some of the institute go for the faculty, doesn't go for the survey. They go for the course and survey. What is the course and survey? Okay, the moment this course has been delivered, I go to the students, try to take a feedback from him. Okay, how do you like this particular course? I make some questionnaire of my own and then take the feedback. Then I go for the evaluation. Now, then what I do is, let's say I go for the evaluation vis-a-vis all the students who are going through the MBA program. In MBA, there are, let's say, in a particular year, they are going for the 10 courses. Then for all the 10 courses, I try to see the course and survey. And then I compare. I draw threshold based on the law of averages only. And from there, I try to find out what is being done is there may be a course and survey is, let's say there are 10 courses which the student has gone through. And I define the threshold for each of the question. And then for at the end of the question, overall assessment of the course, then based on the 10 courses, I try to find out how good or bad this particular teacher has done in this particular course there. Because usually people have got their own, faculty have got their own saying about this, the student evaluation. But yes, this is one of the very standard way of course evaluation, indirect tools for evaluation of a particular course, how exactly has been delivered. Usually we say, there are so many things which are emerging in this. People say students are not very serious. But statistics says... Yes. Yes, you want to ask something?
I've got one question.
Sure.
I'm from a management institute. Now, when you're doing your PEOs or even the graduate attributes, one of the sessions we were told that we have to look how the alumni would be about 4 or 5 years hence, because ultimately that is what we desire the alumni to be. Now, in today's context, sir, with so much of technology coming into management studies, particularly digital formats and all, this is very dynamic. So when I'm doing today, for instance, if I'm having my POs being evaluated, which were framed about maybe a couple of years back, they may look a little outdated, sir. Am I right in my assumption or could you guide us?
No, sir. What we have got is, okay, let's say every year I can't, let's say you've got an MBA program. This particular program will change every
year. Yes, sir. I'm listening. Yes, sir. Yeah.
Right? Okay, every, because let's say you have to deliver a curricula. Curricula, in the digital age also, we say the life of a curricula is a N plus one. What is the N? N is the duration of the course, N plus one. So let's say MBA is a 2-year course and you add one to this, it's a 3-year. And for particular students who enter into your system, usually we say this curriculum will be valid for 2 to 3 years. So my POs will also be valid for that particular course for that many number of years there. So that's what we, once we say is a 3 year data, what we, because you're right in saying, okay, in case your curricula has been changed in between, let's say 3 years is the time which we say is the duration of a curricula. In engineering, we say it's a 5 years. In MBA or a 2 year course, we say it's a 3 year duration. So that's why MBA has kept the evaluation period as 3 years. Now, your question, okay, if my POs changes in between, then what you have to do is you have to give the data for a PO which you have defined initially, then another data with where you have changed the POs. So this is a general practice which is there. Okay, 3 year curricula is there, but usually the curricula changes after 4 years and 5 years. So that's why in case my curricula is having a changes after 4 or 5 years, then my POs will also remain there. The moment I go for major changes into my curricula, only then there will be changes into the POs there. I hope I answered your question.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Because in that case, you're very right in saying, okay, in case my curriculum, let's say I got to give 3 years data and my curricula has changed in between. In that case, I have to give data for a curricula for two times, one for the old curricula, other for the new curricula. So that's what we usually say. Okay, to ease of filing the SAR, you should find out in which 3 years you got a uniform curricula there. But in case the curricula has been changed, obviously you have to bear with that. Fine. I was talking to you about the indirect. Yes, any other question?
Sanjeev, correct me if I'm wrong.
Sure.
We give the course outcome to the Board of Studies well in advance, number one. Number two, the faculty members devise a draft syllabus. The Board of Studies, after some time, deliberate upon the syllabus. In yes. this syllabus, 15% is for the state-of-the-art syllabus. Let us say in computers, it is immersive technologies or cryptography as such. Mm-hmm. Now, this, since it is already course outcome is also given, this course outcome with the Board of Studies recommendation is vetted by the Academic Council. Is it proper or we go the other way around?
Basically, what you're doing is you're trying to, one is initially you go for this mapping, then once you have to attain it, it's every year attainment which you have to draw. Design of a curriculum is only once, and attainment level will keep on varying over there. And KC,
okay.
Because basically what you're to see is, one is the design of a curricula, other is the implementation. Now my attainment will come, keep on changing at the time of attainment, at the time of implementation of that particular curricula there. That's good. I think I'm happy to have as many questions as you feel like. Then what we got is, we got an indirect tools also through which we do it. Okay, your course end survey, exit survey, faculty survey, alumni survey, maybe MBA people, they're all aware of all this. And course end, then you have to close these loops also. That's another thing which MBA looks for. Let's say you indirect tools also, you've gone for the course end survey. Then let's say a student for a particular course said, okay, this course was taught to us in an awful bad way. That is obvious. Obviously, some of the students will be having this sort of opinion about a course. Then what is the remedial measure once the course is to be delivered again, what are the remedial measure which you will be taking? Let's say in case a course is there, let's say system analysis design course was there. It was taught in a way which is not appealing to the students. They gave their feedback. And feedback, what is the director doing with the feedback? What is the HOD doing with the feedback? That is the most important component as far as closing these loops are concerned. Okay, some feedback has come. Then what HOD has done, what faculty has done, and what director has done for that feedback. Okay, some remedial measures which you have taken for the course, because that helps in improvement. Because we talk about a lot of about continuous improvement. That's where you have to think about the improvement. Let's say course has not been taught well. Is there some interaction which had with the faculty for that particular course? That's one thing. In case faculty says, okay, this part is, I don't know much about this part. Have we taken some remedy measure in sending him to some courses there where he can learn it? So that in case he is to teach this course next time, he is teaching in a better way, or I change the teacher. So all these are nothing but the course end survey, which will be there in that particular case. And your exit survey, once after 2 years, the student leaves the institute, they give some feedback. They say this course should be replaced by this course. Let's say there are most of the students say this. Now, have they sent this particular information to my board of studies? Okay, this is what my students are saying. And based on that, there's some changes in the curricula which has happened. Or there are some employer survey which was there. There's also another indirect tool which is there. Employer comes, he says, your students are slightly weak in qualitative analysis. Let's say there's a feedback which has come to me. Have I sent this feedback to the teacher who is taking the statistics part? And what is the improvement he's done? Because this is what we say is the closing of the loop as far as your indirect tools are concerned. That's what we say, CO-PO relationship. Each CO can be identified to address a subset of some of the POs. Time and again, I'm repeating, every CO cannot be linked to every PO there. There is a subset of POs to which each of the CO will be linked. Based on the number of the COs and the sessions dedicated to them, it is possible to identify strength of the mapping, maybe 1, 2, 3 of the POs. And PO metrics we can establish there. Then your attainment is based on the assessment. A assessment should be aligned with the COs there. And question paper should be set to access all the COs there. This is what we say is the mapping with the curricula. Because that's how this particular loop is completed. Okay, you got a POs, you got a COs there. Now how you, let's say one course has got two COs. So how those COs will help me in attaining it? So I have to design accordingly. So let's say in a question paper also, I had defined which this particular question is, I am able to meet this particular CO with this particular question there. That's what we say, question paper should be all so set to assess all COs there. And average marks obtained in assessment against each item for each CO will indicate the CO attainment there. And instructor can set their own target for the CO. This is what I was talking about. If for each of the instructor can set up his target, then what is the achievement? And that can be matched there. And attainment gaps can therefore be identified. And then you have to do some improvement, continuous improvement to align attainment to come out with that particular gaps there. That means the instructor can plan to reduce attainment gap or enhance attainment targets. In case the teacher initially says, I will be attain 60%, he is able to attain 70%. That doesn't mean he has attained something. because he has kept his attainment target very low. That's why his attainment gaps are very low.
Can I have, sir, one question, sir?
Sure. Should I go to back slide? Okay.
Yeah. Actually, the CO attainment are to be made at the end of the semester, I believe.
Yes. Once you have got a continuous evaluation, once you have got a final evaluation, based on that, you have to attain.
So, when it should be? Whether it's at the end of the semester or?
Yeah. It's the end of the semester. Once you have completed the course, because let's say initially you set the target. Mm-hmm. And the course you do all measurements, I'll show you.
Target is written in the PO, no? I believe.
No. Targets are nothing to do with the POs. Target, the moment some course is to be taught, at the time only the student teacher will define, okay, this is the target which I kept. Then he will talk about attainment for that.
Okay, fine? So I believe there will be some questions, there will be some marks of the questions.
For every question, there is certain marks. It will give him the attainment level. Because it's basically complexity there. You have to simplify with how to have this sort of attainments.
Okay. So how can I guess what would be the reference, then what should be the point to be achieved, and whether the
student I'll tell you, it's a progressive only. Initially, if I'm teaching this course for the first time, then I can talk about randomly, okay, this is my target level which will be there. But the moment I had taught it a second time, moment I had taken this third time, then accordingly it will be varying there.
Okay.
Because obviously initially, let's say you don't have got any measurement there. You simply say I'll be attained 70% in this particular course. But later on, all this will keep on varying. Based on your experiences, based on your attainment level, which will change according to the strength of the students there. Let's say a class is there where you thought your attainment level is 90%. Whereas you, the students who have come to you, they are a very poor quality.
Yeah.
You couldn't attain it. Then next time also you go for the admissions. You have seen the similar set of students have come. Similarly, intelligent level student come, then I can reduce my attainment level also. My target level I can reduce, and accordingly I can work over. This is what we look for once we go for the NBA accreditation.
Okay. Sir, may I ask a question?
Sure.
Yeah. Just now, as you mentioned that we may define the attainment level, then how do we, differentiate between an institute which keeps a higher attainment level and doesn't achieve it versus one which has a lower attainment level but achieves it? So how that is,
because that's a very interesting question. As NBA level, we don't go for a comparison between the institutes. There's no comparison. This is here we will be differentiating. You might have heard of NIRF ranking.
Yeah.
Okay, you have heard of NIRF ranking. NIRF ranking ranks the institute. Whereas NBA just says whether you're accredited or not accredited. There is no comparison between accreditation of my institute and accreditation of the other institute.
No. My question is that suppose even within one institute, suppose I have kept a high attainment level. Because the input of students, whatever you had just now, as you have said, because of that, they could not achieve that high attainment level. So even for that institute, will that be taken as negative?
No.
Or is it, little subjective that I should have envisaged the poor quality and I should have kept the attainment level low? That confusion, if you can. Yeah.
No, that's what I'm saying. Okay, at the initial level, let's say in case you start with the course, teaching, then you're defining some parameters there through which you define your attainment level. But next year, if the same course is being taught, then a certain basis based on which you can define, you can lower or up your attainment level. And NBA doesn't mind in case you have lowered your attainment level or you have attainment level very high. But only thing is, they try to see whether the teacher is realistic in this sort of attainment levels or not. And okay. attainment level is based on the previous performance, previous experiences. And these experiences, as I said, your course file is a progressive file. Same way, your attainment levels are also progressive.
Sir, can I ask a question?
Sure.
Good afternoon, sir. So my question is in continuation to the previous question. Where, let's say, an institute has got 7 to 8 different programs, and there is a particular course which is common to these programs.
Okay.
Okay. But some of these programs are core management, and some of them are sectoral, where the input given to that student, assume a finance, is supposed to be at a lower level of input or maybe at a basic level, whereas that particular program which creates specialists out of it should have a higher level of input. So in that case, can you have differing levels of attainments in the same institute for a course which is maybe differently delivered across different programs?
That's what I would like to clarify. For each of the course, you have to define the attainment level. Okay, once you define the target you set, for each of the course, you're setting this target. There's no comparison between one course with the other. As a teacher, I may be having a higher target which I'm setting, and the other teacher may be setting a low target. This is a subjective one.
So if I am...
I'll tell you, again, I'll repeat. It's not a program attainments which where we are targeting. It's a course which we are targeting, and based on that, maybe some program attainments also achieved in that.
Okay.
So answer your question? Because this is a usually doubt in the people's mind. Okay, is it every course should have got a uniform targets? No. Every course can have its own targets based on the performances, based on the complexity of the course there. Maybe let's say you imagine. There is a statistics course which people say is a tough course, and that is another is a qualitative analysis course which is people say is a relatively easy course. Maybe the target for one course may be varying from the other course. Yes, now your question, sir. Sorry.
Yes, sir. Where I have to declare this PO attainment, whether it is to be submitted to the HODs. Or I have to keep it record in my
own... It's a part of your course files.
Oh.
Because every time, that's what I was talking to you about, progressive course files. Okay, once
actually,
we...
Actually, for power, each course, there will be some gradation, okay? So suppose grade A, grade B, grade C, it is written in the syllabus. Suppose if a student get a 90 above, he may get a grade. He can get B grade. It's like this A, B, C, D, or excellent grade, or something else. So there is a gradation. Besides that, CO attainment, and where I have to keep it in my own file, being a teacher. Suppose I am being
yeah,
a teacher,
in your own files on. Because basically, sir, it's a course file where all this information has to be kept.
Individual teacher will keep it.
Yeah, individual, because basically what is a course is delivered by the individual teacher, and every teacher will be keeping this sort of information there with them.
Okay, the teacher will set the target.
Yeah.
Teacher. Okay.
Sir, can I ask you questions?
Sure, sir.
Sir, thanks for throwing light in this area of attainment levels.
Thank you so much. I'm happy to answer so many questions.
Yes, sir. Sir, as the previous questions also were very similar, like in a particular semester, if there are more courses and there could be even at different semesters, different courses which have different difficulty levels. So, as you said, a faculty in this first or three sessions can estimate or, you know, evaluate the students and then fix up according to him what type of attainment levels he can fix.
That's what I'm saying. Every course can have its own attainment level targets, and afterwards he can calculate what's that achievement he's got. That's what I'm saying. I'm again repeating, for every course you have to have a course file where all these attainment and other things should be there. Because what we do is we make a Excel sheet. From there, we calculate all these things.
So it's given to understand that then the NBA team also asks the faculty in terms of attainment levels. That explanation is given as per the difficulty or why, how it is attained.
Because let me explain you again the process. A Dhumani team comes, there is a faculty interaction with each of the individual faculty member there. At the time, faculty member has to take up, go along with this course file, and there he is to explain how exactly he delivered the course, what is the performance of this particular course, what is the attainment level of this course, what is the student feedback which has come for this particular course. All these things has to be explained by the concerned faculty member only.
Yes, sir.
Right?
Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Okay. Thank you so much. So this what we go for the continuous improvement. We just try to close the loop of the course level, program level, and the institute level.
I have one more question, sir.
Sure, sir.
So there may be a situation, supposing like our institute, one course may be taught by two or three teachers. Okay.
So okay.
Who will be the responsible persons to take care of these files or?
Usually what happens is, this is an institute specific only. Otherwise, what happens is every institute, while allocating a course, this is what the assumption is, he make coordinator for the course. Let's say there is a course where 10 lectures are to be delivered by A, 15 by B, and 20 by C. Maybe the fellow who is delivering 20 lectures become the coordinator for the course. And ultimately, because what happens is, ultimately, once you have to evaluate the students, a final examination, maybe in your case, let's say if you take it as a teacher wise, even then to think of while grade is to be given to that student, that will be only single grade for that particular course. Whether there are two teachers, whether there are three teachers.
Okay, definitely.
So maybe there is a institute level only or a department level only. Where they can define this particular file will be presented by this particular faculty. Or two
faculty. They have some guests for a particular course. The guests that may come, they may
Some MBA, that's another issue which is there in MBA. What we do is, whosoever is present at that particular time, only those course file we try to see.
Okay.
I think this is what I say is a thumb rule.
Faculty
member is not there. We don't ask HOD to present the file. Fine.
Okay. Thank you.
Because I think another thing I would like to repeat, NBA teams usually work in a very friendly way.
Okay.
At the time there is something fishy which comes and emerges there, then we have to be slightly more probing. Otherwise, we work in a very friendly way. The way I'm talking to you, the same way we talk in the group there also.
Yeah, good afternoon, sir. I would like to ask a question.
Okay, Kirti.
Yes. Sir, in a particular course, I have six outcomes, course outcomes that are defined. And supposedly it happens that 30 of my students in a class of 60 attempted for that course outcome. So I consider it as a my attainment for this course outcome is fulfilled, because 60 out of 60, 30 has attempted them completely, or I will say that it is just
whatever data you provide, which data only. In case you say the 30 students only gave the test for this particular course, let's say 60 joined this course, only 30 appeared for the course final examination, then we'll take it for the 30 only. Because attainment level, evaluation level has to be based on the students only.
No, there are 60 present and only 30 attempted, and rest 30 don't attempt that.
Then they will be getting zero in that.
Yes. Or we will consider not attempted.
No. There is nothing like not attempted. Because basically, let's say someone attempted a wrong answer, somebody doesn't attempt, is taken as a zero one.
it is taken as a zero. And zero. Sir, I just want to have one more viewpoint from you. When we have to show the proofs to the NBA team, do we have to maintain the whole set of 60 copies with us?
No. Again, that I'll like to clarify. In your, because what we look for there is, we look for only your evaluation pattern there. Let's say what we expect is, in your course file, you would have put 2 to 3 answer sheets there. Maybe in case you don't have got that answer sheet, even in case you got a sessional answer sheets, even that is fine with us.
Okay. And
what we are looking finally is, what is the evaluation you have done, that Excel sheet should be there.
Okay. And sir, lastly, I would like to, maybe in the end of the session, could you please throw some light on the curriculum gaps? Because we are the tier 2. And we belong to tier 2 institutions, so we have...
In tier 2, we don't evaluate you from the course design, curriculum design. We see you in the core curriculum implementation only.
Right. So, please explain what will be the curriculum gaps in that case.
Gaps is, okay, let's say, based on your alumni feedback, based on your exit survey, students say this paper shouldn't be there, this content shouldn't be there. Those are known as the gaps.
Okay.
So, our role is, okay, in case from this sort of a survey, there is something which is there, that you send it to the Board of Studies. That's how, because I'm talking about the closing the loops. So that is at the program level, we have to close this particular loop. Okay, once your curriculum is being designed, at the time you give this feedback, okay, this course shouldn't be there, this content shouldn't be there, this content should be added based on the feedback of the stakeholders. Fine?
Okay.
Right? Okay.
Hello?
Not, okay.
Hello, sir.
Hello.
Yeah, can I ask you one
Swarna.
Question? Yes, sir. Suppose we are doing laboratory assessment for students. Then how many sample journals or assignments should be kept to show to the committee so that we can prove that we are doing such type of assessment? Is there any need or is there any number?
No, we look for a sample, maybe out of 60 students, in case you keep the report of the 2 to 3 students that are fair with us.
Okay, so is it necessary that we should keep it for average student, below average and good student as well? Like, is there any requirement like this?
Not like that, but yes, in case, this, because usually what we expect is 2 to 3 evaluations on.
Yeah.
Copies only, not that they should be best. They should, because what we assume is the teacher is doing justice with the evaluation part.
Yeah, yes.
Because more important is justice as compared to poor student copies or a good student's copies. Maybe project report, we do look for that.
Yeah, project report we want for all.
Not for all. What we look for is, okay, there are 60 students, they have got an industry, they have got to industry for 6 months.
Yes.
Because in MBA, people go for industry for 3 months or this there. So once they come, they submit the report. Now, what we look for is, hey, you should be able to give us 3 very good report, 3 average report, 3 poor reports.
Okay.
And then another thing which some of the committee member do this also, whether your evaluation also matches with that or not.
Okay.
Because it's not that... you say it's an excellent report, but once I see marks, you have given D grade to that fellow.
It should match.
It should match with your evaluation also. Fine.
Okay, but the Excel sheet should just be prepared for everyone.
What I'm trying to do is, I'm just trying to give you thumb rules. Okay, this is how you can do the things in a better way.
Yeah, that is very good suggestion, sir. And you have given very good input for me, sir. This is really
thank
understanding.
You.
Thank you, sir.
Thank
you
very much.
Thank you,
sir. One quick one. We started with the POs.
Dr. Deepa, okay.
Yes, sir. So at some time, if you can also just throw light on the PEO, Program Education Objective.
Program Educational Objective, you have to define.
Yes.
So POs are defined by the accredited agency. That's the only difference.
Correct. So what we should, you know, ensure is covered in the PEO. At some time, if you can just mention that, it will be a good guideline for us.
Yeah, chalo, let me try. If case find time, I'll certainly do.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Okay. It's a very nice session. Maybe I've delivered maybe tens of a session like this, but this is the most interactive session I had. Testing me also, I would say. And you're taking best out of me. That's another thing I would say. Okay, if we have got this continuous improvement. Now, what in continuous improvement we look for is closing the loop of the course level, program level, at the institute level. So that's what we say the quality assurance for the stakeholders. Now, course level, as I explained, okay, once you go through a course, in case the student gives the feedback, this course was not taught properly, or this was missing, this topic has not been covered, then how do I close this loop? If I have to document it also. Okay, I had a meeting with the faculty, and this was what was informed to the faculty, and this is what faculty said, all this needs to be documented so that this loop is closed. Then the program level, in case curricula is there, okay, at the program level, okay, what sort of changes are required and what sort of more content should be there. In case I can pass this information to the Board of Studies, maybe how do it's not that faculty will pass it to the Board of Study. Faculty will give it to the HOD. HOD will send it to the Dean. Dean will send it to the Board of Study. This cycle should be complete. Maybe this documentation should be there in your files, because what MBA looks for is this sort of documentation, how this particular thing is being taken care of. So that's what attainment analysis made to provide continuous improvement either through course delivery assessment and the curriculum. This is my sense of the OB. So what we say is, okay, your outcome-based education has got these three things only, delivery, assessment, and the curriculum. In case our transparency is there, our documents are complete, then nobody can stop your assessment. Leave aside, okay, there are other parameters there through which your NBA accreditation has to be seen there.
Hello.
Yes.
Sir, I want to ask one question regarding the course file.
Regarding the course file, okay.
Yeah. Sir, if I'm showing my course file to the NBA committee,
okay,
then and I am having my COP or attainment with me, in which I have taken so many quizzes, and I have my internal examination as well as external examination. So how many samples I have to show them, or I have to keep them to show?
So that's what I'm saying. It is only 2 to 3. Let's say in case you're going to take given a quiz to the students, keep 2 or 3 quiz copies there with you. What we look
for, if I am giving 5 quizzes and I am judging out of that, I am taking 4 best 4 out of that.
That is fine. Only thing is, it should be documented somewhere, and your record should also reflect that.
And being tier 2, we are not having our external paper with us.
Yeah, that's fine. We accept that. Only in that case, what we do expect is your internals, whatever internals you have done, that should be part of the document.
And for external, if I am dividing the complete marks by number of COs, will that be okay?
Yeah.
Because I cannot find the individual attainment in that.
Yeah, you can't. In that case, you can, because I'll tell you Gujarat model. What they do is they have automated, because this sort of a things require a lot of automation. Gujarat, what they have done is for the evaluation, they don't send the sheets. They have a scan sheets only. And they put the marks on the document only. And from there only, all the information about this sort of requirement are being covered. Whereas manually, in our institute for internal evaluation, that's why we put our, one of my, let me tell you very frankly, we put one of my PhD student, okay, please, this answer sheet has been evaluated. Now, what you do is for each question, you put it and make it an Excel sheet for me. So that's the way we do. But in case of a tier two issue, this may not be feasible. So what we expect is whatever you have done your sessionals, that we try to match it with. Because
And regarding one course, what level of containment is considered as good?
That is relative. We don't compare it with anyone else. In case you say your course attainment, you have kept as 70%, we believe it. I don't ask you why you not kept 80%, why you not kept 90%. Or if you kept 90%, I don't say why you not kept 30%, 40%. Don't
ask. Can that be 100% also?
Yeah, you can. Because you can be excellent teacher. Where you say, okay, my paper was such, that is a scoring paper. So I expect everyone to pass in that. That's why I kept it at 100%.
Fine, sir. Thank you so much.
So what we have got is, we got a continuous improvement there, okay, where the program must regularly use appropriate documented processes for assessing, evaluating the extent to which student outcome been attained. And result to be this systematically utilized as input for the continuous improvement of the program. Okay, in case I have to improve upon the program, because obviously, how do I improve upon the program? In case my courses are improved, my program will obviously be improved in this particular case there. So how faculty engagement in continuous improvement is, how they are focused instead of, because this is what we usually say, instead of saying what do we do to get NBA accreditation, in case we say faculty is focused, then half of the things for the continuous improvement is done. So instead of saying, how can I get NBA accreditation, in case I can say how to improve the student learning, automatically the system will work. Only thing is, our idea should be improve student learning in that process, this particular process, and that can help you in improvement of things. Maybe this is our management plans, they are the process, good results. I'm not going to detail of all this. You are MBA people, you know much better than me this thing, processes, results, and the improvement action which we require. Maybe for engineering, yes, we do discuss this.
So please discuss.
Huh? Okay, you want me to? Okay. Because let's say your director or your, obviously, they will be asking the management people also, how your director and the HOD, how exactly they perceive the continuous improvement. What they have to have this processes is collecting, consolidating, assessment data. Okay, all the data, let's say you as a faculty are doing it for your own course only, but they have to consolidate it and then they collect this sort of data and analyze the report, and this whole report, they can present it to the faculty. And evaluation is there. And your results are based on your data, information, knowledge, decision, curriculum, pedagogy. Because in this whole process, we are talking about a curriculum, but we are not talking about the pedagogy. Okay, let's say, in case you imagine, in this COVID time, COVID delivery has got a paradigm shift. I hope all of you have done it. Because who has decided this thing? It's your management who is to do it. Okay, let's say instead of classroom teaching, I go for the online teaching. There's a paradigm shift, which is the pedagogy which we are trying to work on it. And once I have changed this, obviously I can't have the, then I have to see results of this. In case, let's say you assume, had I come to Delhi to teach you this particular course, perhaps now your 100 people, there may be only 20 people who would have come for that session there. Why? Because first, I may be a bit hesitant to come because I need one day to go to Delhi and come back. Another, everyone has got their own busy schedules, traveling and other things. So all these are what is making impact. So what we say is, how exactly are the results of this? Let's say I gone for the online teaching. What is the result of this? Can they compare result of this online teaching with the offline teaching? How can we do it? Okay, if I ask you people only, how do I find out whether if I would like to compare the online teaching with the offline teaching? Yes, I hope some of you might be doing this online teaching these days. What we have to do in this case is, maybe we have to conduct some survey from the students, what is the impact analysis of the learning through the online media, and management then can plan up how exactly we can do it. Then what sort of improvement actions are there? Your curriculum changes are the ones, pedagogy is the one, there may be some others through which you can go for the improvement. So this is what we see is the management overall perspective. Because online teaching, I gave you the example of online teaching. Online teaching is not the decision of the faculty. It's not the decision of the HOD. It's the decision of the management who is to do it. And then they have to think about what sort of resources are required for this and what is the result out of this. So this is what we say. I gave you the example for the management planning there. Now, as I said, POCO mapping gives you the understanding of program outcome, embedded learning outcome for the individual courses, and assessment methods, extent of learning imbibed by the student. Because there is always a difference between assessment method. It's a measurement of the extent of the learning. I can't say my all the students would have learned it. Because no results gives you 100% performance. So what we have to look for is extent of a learning imbibed by the student there. And we go for the performance rubrics for this particular indicators there. So then we have to this is what we say the need of change of the attitudes. From grading, scoring right, wrong, comparison of students, secretive, exclusive, add-on, challenging faculty. What we have to go to? We have to go for the assessment and consider the whole reasoning process, not going for the right, what is right. No, this is what NBA says. We are not there to say what is right, what is wrong in your system. We have to look for a whole reasoning process as far as the system goes on. And if I'm not comparing the students, I'm comparing the measurable outcomes there. And I'm not secretive. We are public, we are open, we are participative. And public in the sense that whatever you will observe, 5-6 years back, NBA itself was very secretive. They will not share the marks. They will not share the what is the feedback given by each one of the experts. Now they are becoming open. And now they are becoming participative also. And it's embedded and it is for the helping the students there. So this is what we see change of the attitude there. So this is what I thought I'll cover up with. Now I'll come to a simple case study. Okay, hope my Word document is visible. Yes.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, Word document is visible. Right, that's good.
No, sir. PPT.
Sir, it is not visible.
What?
Your slides are visible. You have to change the window, sir, that you are sharing.
Okay. That I'll do. I thought I'll.
So stop sharing the slide, and then you can switch to the Word document.
Okay.
Yes, sir. Now it is visible. Sir, if you could please zoom it a bit.
Okay, sure. I'll do it. Is it fine?
Yes, sir.
Okay. This is COPO course outcome methodology, which is adopted by some other institute. Now, what is the CO attainment through direct assessment? What is there is we need some internal input required for this. Internal assessment marks and semester examination marks are truly spectral from various semester there. And weight is for internal assessment and end semester examination of few days practical. Let's say this is what an institute has defined. Okay, for 17-18, my internal assessment weighted theory subjects will be 20%, and end semester examination will be 80%. Then they further change it to, so this is what we say is continuous improvement. Okay, internal assessment they made it 34%, end semester they made it 66%. How they would have gone through this is, okay, why the experience is there? Okay, instead of 20% is too low a weightage for theory subjects, internal assessment, then they have made it 34%. And project, case study project, which you usually have, there is an internal assessment of 60% and 40% in the end semester examination. And maybe they kept it for the next pass or batch also. So this is what are the evaluation. This is what is required. Okay, weightage as per your curriculum. Now, how will you get it? Either if you are a tier one institute, you can define all these things of your own, or if it is a tier two institute, this will be part of your curriculum there. Now, a first step is the four level of the scale 0 to 3 are considered to measure the attainment depending upon the quality of the result of the class. Okay, based on the result of the class, we try to find out how the performance is there. Now, what is this? Is another definition you have to define. There is no standard rules for this. Every institute, they have to have this sort of a definition there. Okay, let's say in case there are 10% of the students scoring greater than 60% marks, attainment level is 0 only for the internal. And in case there are 10 to 40% students scoring 60%, I can say attainment level is 1. 40 to 60% scoring 60%, attainment level is 2. And 60 to 100% students scoring 60%, attainment level is high. So this is what we have to set initially, or maybe this can be at the course level only. This can be at the department level only. This is how we have to define this sort of attainment levels. And similarly, we have to set it for the end semester theory examination also. We set it like this. I hope this thing is clear. Okay, let me assume that this thing, this table is clear to you. And we same way we define this attainment level for the practical case study and the project. These are, as I said, this is an example. You can think about your own. Okay, in case 0 to 10% student score is 70%. Now, if you look at this, I said 60%, whereas in this case, I go for 70%, because what we assume is for practical, for sessionals, for your project work, for all the things, people get, for practical case study project, people get more marks. So that's what I'm saying. In case 0 to 10% of students scoring 70%, I give the attainment level 0. And if it is, to 40%, I give attainment level 1, and 40 to 60, 2, and 60 to 100, 3. And for some of these courses, there are end semester examination practical sessions also. So also, again, this sort of values can be set up like this. Right. So this is what we see is the definition of the attainment level, which we have set up for there. And then we computation of CO attainment for each subject courses. For each subject, the attainment level is found using table 2. For theory subject, table 3 for the attainment level of the skills is termed as X1 for internal assessment, X2 for end term examination. The CO attainment for each subject is CO attainment is this. What is the weightage? What is the X1? What is the weightage? What is the X2? And this gives me the attainment level for each subject or the course. This is the simplest way. Even if you go this way also, whereas attainment level called for a subject, don't count for the other component there. Even this is fine. So this is how we calculate for each of the course. For internal assessment of theory subject, percent of students scoring 60%, we calculate this like this and calculate this particular weightage is there. For that's what we do for each of the course, we calculate this sort of averaging there. For each of the semester we do it, and this we have to do it for 3 years. And same way we calculate it for the practicals also. Same formulas, attainment level and percent of the student attainment level, and we go by this sort of weightage. And these CO attainment level are being used to calculate the POs there. So let's say these were the POs which were there. Corresponding to each of the course, we get this particular table there. And then we say attainment of POs for the jth course through the direct assessment is calculated using this particular correlation, this particular formula. PO attainment is CRG. This is some factors divided by 3, where I is number of POs and PSOs, and I the number of courses from this to this master. For all the courses, we calculate this value. And this is the values which we get in this.
Sir, could you please explain this particular formula once again? Means I couldn't get it. And like for attainment of.
Okay, I'll go again, go back to the previous one. Okay, what we have got is, okay, this is the definition which we define for the attainment levels. Maybe I'll pass on this particular sample example to you.
Would be great, sir. Would be great. Means.
I'll pass on this. Don't worry. Then CO attainment for each subject is calculated as what is W1 X1 and W2 X2. What is X1 and X2 for the internal assessment, and X2 is the semester examination. We get this particular CO attainment for a particular subject or a course there. Fine.
Yes, sir.
Then we have this particular value.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes.
Can I ask one question?
Sure.
Sir, for this CO attainment, is indirect assessment tools are valid to use?
I'll come to that, because we have what we have to do is you have to define the formula. Okay, let's say you say 80% of the direct assessment and 20% of the indirect assessment. That's how we define this sort of a formula.
Yeah, but my question is it valid to use the indirect assessment for CO? Because for PO we use it definitely for the different events and other things what we conduct for that. But for CO, is it valid to use? Because sometimes we take the end course survey or some other surveys from the students. So yes. My question is it valid to take the indirect assessment for CO attainment?
Only thing is we give it a less weightage. In case
yes, 60
a weightage I give for the direct assessment, I'll give only 20% for the indirect assessment. Because you're
yes, right, sir.
Indirect are right. Always subjective. Whereas yes. This attainment level which we have got for the scoring based on that. Fine.
Okay. Okay. Thank you, sir.
So this is a table contained computation of CO attainment for the theory subject. Whatever are the courses there, percent of the students scoring 60% of marks, levels based on that, whatever attainment level which we have defined. And CO 8 is W1 X1, W2 X2. And we calculate for each of this particular course there. CO, that's what we say the CO attainment. And the same way we can computation of CO attainment for the practical courses also. Okay, what are the courses? And we, for each of the course, we got this particular values there, which is the CO attainment for that particular practical course there. Now let's see, this is what a course is, system analysis design. These are the some of the POs which are available to this. And this table 6 provides the correlation on the scale 1 to 3 between each course and the course. So let's say on this particular side, we got all the courses. And on this particular side, we have got all my POs.
Sir, on what basis we usually map? What is the criteria? Like, which particular PO is being addressed by which particular CO? This is the one case. But how we usually grade them 3, 2, 1? What is the parameter for that?
Parameter is if it's mapping, then we say 3. If it's average mapping, we say 2. If it's a very low mapping, then we say 1.
Sir, what is the basis of mapping means mapping number of lectures?
Based on the question, based on the content which we are teaching.
Okay, say, that is subjective. That is subjective.
What we have got is, let's say, we say, okay, in case a course is there, it has got my PO was, it should increase the mathematical orientation of the students. Let's say I'm teaching statistics as a course. It will increase mathematical orientation of the course. I can see it's a 3.
Okay.
But in case there is something like this, it should take care of ethics of the student.
Yes,
sir. It may not take any ethics as far as statistics is concerned. Whereas project work, in case it's a teamwork and other things which are there, and my PO is ethics and teamwork, then maybe it is more focused towards teamwork as compared to less towards the mathematical field.
Yes.
Right? So that's how we define all this.
Okay. So this particular thing is going to be defined by individual faculty?
What we have to do is, okay, this particular table has to be part of the SAR.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So some of you will have to collect all the information from a faculty member and put up in this particular document.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Okay.
Excuse me, sir.
Okay.
I have one more question. Sir, regarding this extent of correlation 3-2-1 of CO and PO. So, as sir has asked the question, how to do this? So instead of being a little bit judgmental, can we use that examination reform policy document provided by AICT, where it is maintaining the performance indicators and competencies?
If you want, I can also pass that document to you.
Yes.
You don't have got, but it's available on the AICT website. What?
Right.
Say the similar things.
Okay, but can we use it for formally reasoning to have this mapping?
Sure, you can.
Yeah, okay, sir. Thank you.
So that's what, okay, it's based on the scale of 1, 2, 3 between each other. That's a correlation. And we just program attainment is CRIJ into course achievement. Okay. Attainment for that particular JS course divided by 3. Some formula they have defined, and it gives you all the attainment for all the POs and the POs corresponding to a program there. I hope now the things are clear, because basically it's a 1, 2, 3 which you have to define, and this is a correlation which we have got, and you multiply it with the attainment which you got for this particular course and for all the number of POs there and all the number of courses, we find out this particular PO, PO attainment IJ there. So this is how this will be defined, your POs attainment through the direct assessment there. So we just average it out. And now we did this for direct. Now indirect is, we have got some statement of question where we rated excellent, very good, average, and the poor. And based on that, we define this particular grade. Let's say we have got this particular graduating exit survey there, through which we define all these things. We got a question, some question formats are there, and we just go for this sort of a mapping. Okay, which question, yes.
Yeah. Sir, suppose we have mapped this particular PO 2-3, okay, and I have attained this on suppose 2.1 or 2.2.
Are you talking about indirect achievement or direct
achievement? This is not attained. And the mapping is 3, so what will have to be done? So how can I get that?
No, my question is, are you talking about this questionnaire format or back screen?
No, suppose in the mapping, in a particular CO, for a PO 1, it may be mentioned for 3. Okay, we have in the mapping. COPO mapping, it is mentioned 3. But in the COPO attainment, attainment maybe for it is 2.5 or 2.6.
All right, that will always have these values.
Okay, yeah. So whether we have attained it or not.
We can say, you can see it's a 60% attainment or 40% attainment vis-a-vis this.
Okay. So whether we have to need any other additional improvements or how the improvement can be made?
No,
can
as I said, this is a continuous improvement. This particular table is going to draw for every semester, every year.
Every year?
At the end of the year, you have to have this sort of a tables.
Okay.
Then only you can do.
So, as are generally at the end of the program, no? So that's why I am getting confused.
If you do it after 2 years, it's the end of the program, because in that case you will be considering all, let's say in case you consider only 1 year, you may be considering 10 papers. In case you're considering all 20 papers there, then it will be for the year also, 2 years also.
If it is a 4-year degree course, undergraduate course, at the end of the 4th year we have to do it.
I'll tell you why these tables are there is, these similar tables are there in the SAR, self-assessment report. There you have to put for all the 4 years. All the 4 years for 3 years.
From the second year onwards?
First year. Because I'm focusing more upon MBA, that's what I'm time and again I'm saying 2 years. Otherwise, for engineering, it's a 4 years.
It's a 4 year.
Yeah.
So,
for 3 years. Just like CAY minus one, CAY minus two. I hope somebody might talk to you about CAY minus one, CAY minus two.
Okay. Okay.
So then, yes. Then what we do is, okay, then we have got some questions which we are to rate. Okay, let's say there are some surveys which were there, let's say graduate student surveys are there. Some statements you will put. And based on the statement, the people have to rate. And each of the statement, I have to map in one of the, each of these questions. Let's say there are 10 questions there. Each of these questions has to map with some of the POs there. Either or PSOs there, and then once maybe one question can map to more than one POs also. And once I got this mapping, then I can calculate this particular values there. Okay, based on this particular options, I can calculate this particular values. Okay, how do we do it? In case the one student says 5, other says 4, then other says 3, others say 4, then you total it up and find the value over there. Corresponding to one question, what is the values which are there? And then we calculate corresponding to each one of them, what sort of a attainment is there using this particular form. This surveys we conduct for alumni, employer, then how do we compute it? We just say PO indirect test, points for PO student, this alumni, and then I define the weightages. Okay, 40% weightage is for the student exit survey, 30% the alumni, 30% for the employee survey. And corresponding to this, I calculate PO student and 3P alumni and this particular values there and can come out with the values. This I repeated for all the N number of POs and the PUs there, and I get the values. Exit survey, alumni survey, employee survey, I get all the values and get this particular PO indirect I into 3/5, sum of this particular factors. And as I said, then you have to define how much you would like to give weightage for the direct assessment, how much you would like to weightage for the indirect assessment, maybe 80-40, IPO overall is this particular direct and the indirect assessment there. Corresponding each of the I calculate this particular value there and calculate PO direct, PO indirect and overall PO attainment. This is what the table which they are looking for as far as this particular table is concerned. What I'll do is, this is a very simple calculation which are there framed by one of the institute. There, I'll pass on this particular information to you all. Fine. Maybe this is what, now in case there are more questions, there, I think I have got few more things to discuss. Maybe I don't know, running out of time. I stop here. Then it was a very nice session. Maybe in case there are still some question, I'll be happy to answer them.
Thank you so much, sir. It was a wonderful session, and I think the participants have disturbed you a lot today with the numerous questions.
I enjoyed it, I would say. Actually, it's a really enjoying session, I would say.
Hello, Ritika, may I ask a question, please?
Please, what's your...
Anuradha. Anuradha Basu here.
Oh, yes, ma'am. Please, ma'am. Please ask the question.
Yes, Anuradha.
Good evening. Good evening, sir, and good evening to everybody. I had been waiting to ask this question of you. Can you, am I audible?
Yeah, you're audible.
Yeah, I've been waiting to ask this question ever since our institute has decided to go for NBA accreditation. Since all this design of documentation, etc., was done before the COVID era, now that we are into COVID and into online teaching, the challenges of a teacher are too, both for teacher and student are too many. For students, it's network. For teachers, it's the students are logging in and not hearing, etc. So, is there any accommodation or any adjustments that needs to be done because of this, sir? That's my question.
There is nothing like this. Because obviously, it is delivery system. As I was telling you, delivery system, evaluation system. It's not because COVID has taught us one thing. It's not the physical delivery which has to be there. It can be online delivery also.
Okay.
In that case, in case my institute is following online evolution also, even that will also be acceptable to the NBA. They will not differentiate. Okay. Only thing is, it should be transparent. That's what we have to see.
Okay. Okay. Thank you, sir.
Okay. Thank you.
Any other participant has a question?
May I ask? Hello?
Ma'am.
Yeah, that matrix was shown where, you know, the gradation 40 to 60, above 60. Could there be other ways, average if it is taken, or, some more elaborate?
This is, I'll tell you, this matrix is institute specific. Okay. Every institute can have their own matrix as far as this particular thing is concerned.
Okay. So,
Madam, I want to ask one question.
Okay. Yes, maybe in case madam is running out of time, what you can do is mail me the question.
One very important question, sir, I want to clear.
Sure.
Yeah. Due to this pandemic, so what has happened last semester, students haven't appeared for examination.
Yeah.
So we don't have their results and such kind of documents with us. So what will be the document if we are going to submit now our SAR in 2021? So what we will show for them in 1920s batch?
I think I'll tell you one thing. NBA teams are also human beings only. COVID is happening once in a century.
Yes,
people
sir.
Do not forget, they will accept whatever documents you will give.
Okay, sir. Yeah. Very nice. Ha. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much.
Are you audible?
Yeah. Yes. Ritika, are you sharing something?
Sir, if we need your mail ID for further communication, sir.
I'll just type.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
I hope all of you have got my email address.
Yes, sir.
Okay, thanks a lot. Everyone says it's a pretty good session. I'm too delighted to talk to all of you. Okay, Ritika, your mindset is good also. Thanks a lot. Thank you very much. Okay, somebody say thanks for adding the management perspective, because I was told by Dr. Huda that management perspective was missing. So being from computer science, I can fall in both the areas, management as a computer. So that's why I kept my orientation towards management session only. Thank you.
Sir, am I?
Yeah, you're audible. Because you're sharing your screens, I think. Ritika? Dr. Ritika? You all start sharing some of the screens, that's why there is some issues. Maybe in case you can stop sharing, maybe it will help us out. Yeah, somebody said
hello.
You should have been kept earlier. That's interesting.
Hello.
Yeah.
Professor Sofat, am I audible?
I hope I am.
Yeah, you're audible, sir.
To everybody. Thank you so much, sir, for the wonderful session. I will thank you again. Please accept the certificate from our side as a token of remembrance for this wonderful session. I think our participants still have a number of questions and connecting to you again also. Thank you so much for this wonderful session.
Okay, thank you. Thanks, Ritika. It was a nice interacting with all of you. It was a very interesting, because as a teacher, once the students are happy with the session, that gives you a lot of satisfaction. Thank you for the certificate. Thanks for all the hospitality. Thank you so much. Now let's enjoy our
work. Thank you.
Okay.
But sir, I also thank all my participants who have been with us through this week-long faculty development program. We shall be closing this room now. and we shall be reopening the room sharp at 3:45 for the second session. That is the last session of this faculty development program, followed by the valedictory. So soon after the second session, the valedictory is going to continue. A few participants have still not filled the course exit survey and the feedback form. I request those participants kindly submit both the feedback form and the course exit survey. Meanwhile, we shall be quickly closing this room and reopening it again for the second session. So, Uttam sir, I think close the room. Thank you, Sanjeev sir. Thank you once again.
Thank you. Okay, thank you very much. I'm also leaving. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Uttam sir, I think we can close the session and restart it again.
Ma'am, is it mandatory to email the feedback apart from filling it online?
Yes, ma'am. That is because that it has been UPI has been designed such.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, ma'am. I think there is a network glitch. Uttam sir, try closing the session if possible.
जी मैम।